And that's November 8th. And that's
Day after the election.
That's at
No, 6 o'clock.
6 o'clock at night.
We always do evening.
Cadaver lab.
Cadaver lab.
That is, we actually go into the area at Logan Chiropractic College, and we actually view the cadavers and one of the, they actually go through the entire cadaver. We don't actually dissect, but we view, and then we get to handle different organs and see diseased versus regular brain, lungs, heart, which was fascinating. So we actually get to, like, you know, pass those around and touch them. So we don't actually dissect, but we view different dissected bodies. A normal one, a diseased body, it's really kind of fascinating.
Is it the same lady?
It's different every time.
No, what is it? I've been there twice. It's been the same lady.
Well, I had a guy. I went.
No, I mean the dead lady.
Oh, the dead lady. Been there like 8 years.
No, no, she's been there like 18 months or something.
No, it was years. She's been there a long time.
How long of a time is the?
No, it's really cool though.
It's awesome.
Two hours are we usually there?
2 hours, yeah.
Yeah. 2 hours.
You can live with
I'm going to camp.
Just come see me like during lab, and because I want to get everybody's email address too, so I can send out reminders. Or
Wednesday,
I can always send them around. I'll do that. I'll send a sheet around.
On Thursday, but the election is going on.
Okay, for cadaver lab, you can directly go to the Logan College. It's not far from here, just a bit. And for the Danforth, probably we'll meet the first floor of this building at around 1 o'clock, and then we'll try to car to take 2 or 3 cars. Our college, not our building, where we have started by.
I would do that for a living if I were younger.
It's always nice to explore new fields to see if you like that field, and if you like, you can, you know, pursue your career in that field too. Okay, so anyway.
Are they going in over there because they're near the Danforth Center?
Yes, that's the main reason. Okay, so we'll talk about, today we'll talk about the second part of the respiratory system. And in this part, first we'll talk about the respiratory volumes and capacities. Then we'll talk about the partial pressure of gases. Partial pressure of gases in different locations, and how the partial pressure of gases help in the movement of gases from one compartment to another. We'll talk about partial pressures and movement of gases. Then we'll talk about the factors influences, the factors influence the oxygen saturation. You know that the hemoglobin of red blood cells of blood binds with the oxygen, right? Mainly. So what are the factors that influence that binding of oxygen and hemoglobin? We'll talk about that. And then we'll talk about the regulation of respiration by the nervous system. So how the brain centers control the respiration. Then we'll talk about few clinical conditions related to the respiratory system. So first, we'll talk about the respiratory volumes. There are four respiratory volumes. What are those? The tidal volume, or TV, inspiratory reserve volume, or IRV, expiratory reserve volume, or ERV, and residual volume, or RV. Those four are the volumes. So, what is tidal volume? Tidal volume is the volume of or amount that we inhale or exhale during normal breathing. So during normal breathing, how much air we take or exhale. Remember, the volume of air we take inside our lung, same volume of air we exhale. Okay? So the volume of air that we inhale or exhale during normal breathing. That's the final volume. Okay? The average volume, tidal volume, is 500 milliliters or half a liter, both female and female. Then inspiratory reserve volume or IRV, the amount of air that can be forcefully inhaled after a normal tidal volume inhalation. That means when you normally inhale air 500 milliliter, you inhale the air. Now, if I ask you, stop there and take more air inside, can you do that? Normal inhalation, normally you take 500 milliliter, and if I ask you, stop and try to take more, can you do it?
Yeah.
Yes, you can take more, right? Than normal. The amount you can take beyond the tidal volume, beyond the normal inhalation, that volume is the inspiratory reserve volume. Reserve indicates that we can do that, but normally we don't use that. Right? We have that capacity, but we normally don't do that. In normal breathing, we don't do that, but if we want, we can use that volume. Okay. And it is 3.1 liter in adult male and 1.9 liter in adult female. So female has less inspiratory reserve volume than the male.
Does this make a difference in how long you can hold your breath?
Yes.
So males can just naturally hold their breath?
Not really, because the male can hold more, but they need more. So they use their body, use that air more fast. So actually, right. Expiratory reserve volume. The excessive air that you can exhale after normal exhalation. If you exhale the air normally, 500 milliliter. Now, if I ask you, push more air out from your lung, you can do that, right? And that excessive volume of air that you can exhale after normal exhalation. Make sense? That is the expiratory reserve volume. Again, the reserve means you have that capacity, but you don't normally use that. If you want, you can do that. Residual volume is the amount of air remaining in the lungs after a forced exhalation. If I ask you, exhale the air out as much as you can, forcefully try to exhale all the air out from your lung. Okay? Still, your lung will have some air inside that you will never be able to exhale out. Okay? And that air that will remain in the lung even after the forceful exhalation. Make sense? That volume is the residual volume. That residual volume is very important, because if you exhale all the air out from the lung, then lung will collapse. Okay? Number one. Number two, so to keep the lung expanded in some extent, you need to keep some air inside all the time. Make sense? Number two, if you can exhale all the air out, then your blood is continuously going to the lung, right? Your heart will not stop. Your heart is pumping continuously, right? So blood will go to the lung, and blood will come back without getting any oxygen. No oxygen, blood will get. Make sense? So some air should be always present inside your lung, so blood will at least get some oxygen. So that's the residual volume and its importance, okay? Now you can ask me why adult male has more reserve volume than the female. First, simplest way to think is that the surface area, the average surface area is bigger in male than the female. So the size of the chest, size of the lung is bigger, so the volume is bigger in male. And number two, the metabolism is more. Male body usually is more muscular. Female body is less muscular. So more metabolism occurs in males. So male need more oxygen.
If a person is like a singer or a musician, then you use your, is that probably bigger if you train yourself?
You use your reserve volumes more.
Right. So can it, can you make your reserve volume larger?
Yes.
Because of like training?
By training. Uh-huh. You can change a lot, yes, uh-huh. By training. Very good question. Another is how the male reserve volume is more because male body is more muscular. That's why the muscles are stronger too, okay? Lung size is bigger and body needs more oxygen for metabolism. So because of those factors, we need more reserve volume in male than the female. Okay, and by training, you can, you are right, by training, you can know mainly how to use that reserve air better, more efficiently. That's the main thing happens in training, okay? How you can use better. Like musicians, as she said, they know how to use that extra volume in better way. That's the trick.
So like, is this saying that when you take a man and a woman who are built approximately the same build, that the man will still have more?
Still have more because male body is more muscular than the female. Female has more fat in the body. Okay? Less oxygen is needed. Okay. The capacity, so we are talking about four volumes. Remember, those are the volumes. And capacities are calculated by adding the volumes. So capacities we get by adding different volumes together. What are the respiratory capacities? Respiratory capacity or IC, functional residual capacity or FRC, vital capacity VC, and total lung capacity. So those are the capacities of the lungs. So just know, as I told you, the capacities we get by adding the volumes, right? Adding different volumes, we get the capacity. So total lung capacity is, if you add the tidal volume, inspiratory reserve volume, expiratory reserve volume, and residual volume. If you add all four volumes that we have just talked about, if you add all four volumes together, you will get the total lung capacity of a person. Vital capacity equals to tidal volume plus inspiratory reserve volume plus expiratory reserve volume. If you add those three volumes, that will give you the vital capacity. Inspiratory capacity equals to tidal volume plus inspiratory reserve volume, because it is the inspiratory capacity, remember. So inspiratory reserve volume plus tidal volume. And functional residual capacity equals to expiratory reserve volume and residual volume. So just know how you will get those capacities by adding which volumes you'll get, okay? So, but in case of volumes, I will ask you, what is inspiratory reserve volume, what is tidal volume, what is expiratory reserve volume, what is residual volume? I will ask the definition. And in case of capacity, I will ask you how you'll get those volumes, capacity, okay, by adding each volumes. So this chart, this graph is showing those volumes. So this is normal breathing, this area, okay? Normal breathing, 500 milliliter, that's the tidal volume, inspiration, expiration. This volume is showing the air inside your lung, okay? So when we inhale the air, the volume of air inside your lung will increase, right? So So it will move up. When you will exhale the air, the volume will go down. How much? 500 in normal breathing, right? So 500 milliliter go up and down. That's the tidal volume, right? Now, if I ask you, after you inhale, see here, you are inhaling here, that is the tidal volume, normal 500 milliliter, you have inhaled, right? Normal. Then if I ask you, stop and take more, you can take more, right? You can take more. And this is the extra volume that you can take inside your lung by forceful inspiration. Okay? And that volume is called the inspiratory reserve volume, this volume. You can take beyond the normal inspiration. And here, after you exhale the air, this is the tidal exhalation. Now if I ask you after you normally exhale the air, if I ask you to forcefully exhale more air, you can do that, right? So it will go down. Inside the lung, the volume will go down, right? You are exhaling the air out. So it will go down. And this part is called the expiratory reserve volume. Make sense? The excess air you can forcefully exhale out. Okay. And now, after you forcefully exhale the air out, then I said that still some air will remain in the lung that you will never be able to forcefully push out. That is the residual volume, right? So that will always stay inside the lung even if you forcefully exhale the air. And that's the residual volume, and that will keep the lung expanded and ensure that your blood is getting at least some oxygen from the lung.
Okay, what's the purpose of showing this on
the
graph?
Mm-hmm.
What's the purpose of showing this on
the graph? Just showing that inside the lung, how the volume of air is changing. Okay. Inside the lung, in different conditions, the air is volume of air is changing in the lung, right? How much air will remain inside the lung? Okay, now we'll talk about the dead space. Okay. You know that inside your respiratory system we have two parts, the conductive part and the HMs or respiratory part, right? Mm-hmm. So now if you see, this is your respiratory system. And this part in the wall doesn't have any holes, so air will just be conducted through this part of the tube. Now if in this part, that's the respiratory part, where you have many pores or holes, so this is the gas exchange part, right? Now, the air is located everywhere. The air is present in the conductive, inside the conductive part, okay? That is the anatomical dead space.
Wasn't this on the test?
Yeah.
Anatomical?
Yeah.
Yeah, this was
the test. We haven't gone over it.
Okay. I'll give you 1 point.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
So, anatomical dead space is the area where no gas exchange will take place. Make sense? No gas exchange will occur. This volume is the anatomical dead space, or this space is the anatomical dead space. Remember, dead means it's not taking part in gas exchange. Make sense? Okay. Now, the air in this part, this air is taking part in gas exchange. Okay. So, that's not the dead space. Now, inside the lung, lung is filled with what?
Alveoli.
Alveoli. Tiny balls, right? Air balls. Now, if some of these alveoli, through the wall of these alveoli, no gas exchange occurs, then this will also be considered as dead space because that gas is not taking part in.
You're talking about just one alveoli?
No, few alveoli. Just think that. One or more. These are the alveoli, right?
Right.
Now just think that these alveoli are taking part in gas exchange through the wall. And these alveoli, for example, some disease can block the holes in the wall of the alveoli. So these alveoli are not taking part in gas exchange. Make sense? So since no gas exchange is occurring, those will be considered as dead space. Okay? So, okay, so that's the dead space. So in this case, this dead space will be called the alveolar dead space. Okay? Alveolar dead space. Okay, so you've got the difference between the anatomical dead space and the alveolar dead space. Now, how the alveolar dead space can be created? Alveolar dead space can be created in clinical, in diseases, in clinical conditions. Normally, we expect that all alveoli will participate in gas exchange, right? If your alveoli are healthy, they will participate in gas exchange. Now, just think that there is a clinical condition that is called emphysema, in which the wall of alveoli are destroyed. So that part is not taking part in the gas exchange. Okay? So that's the alveolar dead space. Another is...
can you write the name of it, please?
We'll talk about that in the last part of the lecture. Okay? Now, another is... you know that the alveolar duct. Do you remember alveolar duct?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and these are the alveoli, right? It's like grapes attached to the stem. So, alveolar duct. Now, we have many alveolar ducts and alveolar sacs like this. Many alveolar ducts and alveolar sacs. Now, if any obstacle is here, something blocks this alveolar duct, okay? Then what will happen? These alveoli will participate in gas exchange, right? But these alveoli are not getting any gas. Gas is not going in. Mm-hmm. So this part is now considered as
dead
space. Okay? So obstructive diseases can create a lot of alveolar dead space. Now, interesting thing, another, although I don't want to spend too much time on this, but heart failure. This is your lung, and the pulmonary blood vessels enter the lung, and then branches like this, okay? So, in heart failure, the blood pressure is low. Heart cannot pump the blood, right? In heart failure, your heart cannot pump the blood forcefully. Now, if your heart pumps the blood very weak, then the blood will enter into the lung very weak, with weak force. So, since the blood has to reach to the top of the lung, because alveoli are here, too, that force of blood may not send the blood to the upper part of the lung, but blood will go to this part because of gravitation and... other thing. So this part will not get any blood. Although these alveoli are getting gas here. Make sense? So if blood cannot go, those alveoli will not participate in gas exchange. Make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So that's another way alveolar dead space can be created. Although those have the gases, but blood is not going. So not participating in gas exchange. So there are many ways the alveolar dead space can be created. Now, anatomical dead space is fixed because just think that your trachea is a tube, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's just conducting the gas. And you cannot change the shape of the trachea. It is fixed, right? Your trachea is fixed. Now, alveolar dead space, for example, you have blockage here. Now, if you do a lot of exercise, inhale, exhale the air forcefully, then this can be removed. Then this volume will be added to the gas exchange area, right? So, alveolar dead space can be changed a lot by medicine or by exercise, but anatomical dead
limited space, is the structure, your trachea, your larynx, those are fixed volume, okay?
So how does it remove the obstruction?
Okay.
How does the exercise remove the obstruction?
When you forcefully inhale or exhale the air, that can press that obstacle and remove it. That's why if you do regular exercise, your lung capacity increases. Because some, if there is any blockage or constriction, that will increase. Okay. The total daily space is very easy. If you add all, both the anatomical and alveolar daily space, you'll get total daily space. Now we'll talk about the external and internal respiration. Okay. External expiration is the exchange of oxygen and carbon dioxide across the respiratory membrane in the lung between the alveoli and the capillary blood. And three factors influence the external respiration, how much exchange will occur through the respiratory membrane. We have talked about the respiratory membrane. And through the respiratory membrane, how much exchange of gas will occur, that is influenced by three factors. What are those? Partial pressure gradients and gas solubilities. Okay, that is number one. What is that? If this is the respiratory membrane, this is your respiratory membrane. This is alveolar side, so air. This is the capillary side, so blood, okay? So, if the air pressure, just example, is 100 here, and in this side, you have gas pressure 40, which way the gas will move? From high to?
Low.
Very good. Now, if this pressure goes down to 60, then less air will move, right? So the pressure different. Is one factor, important factor. If the pressure difference is more, then more gas will move from one side to the other side. Another is gas solubilities to the respiratory membrane. You know that when we have studied the cell membrane is a phospholipid structure, and lipid soluble substances will pass through the phospholipid bilayer easily, because lipid will mix easily with lipid, right? But water will not easily pass through the lipid membrane. Do you remember that? Because water, the lipid repels the water. We know that water doesn't mix with lipid easily, right? So the solubility of the respiratory membrane to the gas is important, right? If the gas can mix with the wall structure of the wall of the respiratory membrane, then it will be easily able to pass through the membrane. If it is not, it will not be able to pass through the membrane easily. Remember that the solubility of carbon dioxide and oxygen is different. So they will pass through the respiratory membrane in different volumes. We'll talk about that. Another is ventilation perfusion properly. Very important factor. What is that? Ventilation. What is pulmonary ventilation?
That's
breathing. Pulmonary ventilation is breathing, right? Inhaling, exhaling. Yeah, that is the pulmonary ventilation. We have talked about that in last class. Okay. Now, that is ventilation. Inhaling, exhaling, yeah, or breathing. And perfusion. Your heart is pumping the blood and sending the blood to the lungs, right? That is the perfusion. So your lung is getting blood. That is the perfusion. And now, you think that when you are taking the air inside your lung, that is ventilation, right?
Mm-hmm.
You are taking the air inside your lung. That is ventilation, right? Now, when you are taking the blood inside your lung, at the same time, your heart should send blood to the lung, because blood will go to the lung to get that oxygen, right? Now, that those two things should be coupled very accurately, in timely fashion, timely manner. Make sense? If when you are exhaling the air out, if the blood goes to the lung, then it will not get enough oxygen. When you are taking the air inside the lung, at the same time if blood goes to the lung from the heart, then the blood will get more oxygen. Is it clear? So when you are taking the air, the heart should send the blood to the lung at the same time. So that way the blood will get more oxygen. And that coupling is very important for.
So you said that ventilation and perfusion occur simultaneously?
Yes.
That's what coupling
yes.
is?
Yes, coupling. That's the coupling. Okay? Now, the timing should be maintained. Yes?
So I like if you run and you get like a cramp, it's because it's not enough blood, it won't. You hear that I got a point?
Cramp of what? Muscle?
I guess, I don't know, just, and then like I ran track and they said you gotta breathe when you step. I don't know if it is like correlated to like breathing and getting.
Not really. Your heart is still pumping the blood to the lung and you're breathing, unless you're breathing stopped, then if you want to go. So two things, the breathing and the blood going to the lung, right?
So the blood has to be coming to the lung while you're breathing
in. Yes, yes.
So that doesn't mean that the heart is pumping it when you're breathing in. Right. It just has to get to the lung.
Yes. Structure of the respiratory membrane. Now, see, this is the respiratory membrane. These are the holes in the alveolar wall. We know that in the respiratory membrane there are many holes. Now, if the number of holes is more, then more gas will pass through it. If someone's respiratory membrane has less holes, then less gas will pass through it. So the structure of the respiratory membrane is another factor. In many clinical conditions, the holes or pores get closed, as I told you before. So the quality of the respiratory membrane is another very important factor, right? If there are many holes, then more gas will pass through. If the holes get closed because of change of the structure, then the exchange will be affected. So those are the three factors that will influence the exchange of gas. Now, partial pressure. How the partial pressure help in the transportation of gas. To know that, first you need to know the partial pressures in different locations where gas exchange takes place. Okay, now inside the alveoli of your lung, the pressure of oxygen is 104 millimeter of mercury. 104 millimeter of mercury in the alveoli. Pressure of what? Pressure of oxygen. Now, the heart sends the deoxygenated blood to the lung. You know that, right? So blood will get oxygen in the lung. So in the capillary, venous blood, the pressure of oxygen in the blood is 40 millimeter of mercury. So which way the oxygen will move? Oxygen will move from high to low. That means from the alveoli to the blood. Make sense? In the blood it is 40, in the alveoli it is 104. So what's the difference? 64 millimeter of mercury. That's a lot, right? So because of that 64 millimeter of mercury pressure difference, the oxygen will move from the lung to the blood, from the alveoli to the blood. Okay. Now, the pressure of carbon dioxide.
Did you say the pressure of oxygen in the blood, or just the pressure of the blood?
We are talking about the pressure of oxygen. Okay. Now, what happens in case of carbon dioxide? The pressure of carbon dioxide in the alveoli is 40 millimeter of mercury. So pressure of carbon dioxide is 40 millimeter of mercury in the alveoli of the lung, or in the lung. And in the venous blood, the pressure of carbon dioxide is 45 in the blood. The pressure of carbon dioxide is 45. Now you tell me, which way the carbon dioxide will move? In the blood it is 45, in the alveoli it is 40. go into the alveoli, right? So that's how the carbon dioxide from the blood goes to the alveoli, and from the alveoli, the oxygen goes to the blood. That's how the blood takes oxygen from the lung and delivers carbon dioxide to the blood. Okay? So that happens in the lung. Now,
so what makes the pressure different than carbon dioxide as opposed to the amount
decides the pressure. Okay? If more, the volume is more mixed in blood, the amount is more, then the pressure is more. It's like solution. When you make the solution, if you add more sugar in water, then the pressure of sugar is more. Okay. Now, one thing. What's the pressure difference of oxygen between the alveoli and blood? What's the difference? 64, right? And what's the difference of carbon dioxide between the blood and alveoli?
5.
See, big difference, right? 64 and 5. But same amount of oxygen and carbon dioxide is transported. The reason is the solubility. I told you that solubility to the wall is another important factor. And carbon dioxide is 20 times more soluble than oxygen. So if carbon dioxide is more soluble, small pressure will get more carbon dioxide to pass through it. Right? If the gas is not soluble to the respiratory membrane, then the membrane will repel the gas. So that's why. Yeah, it is there. Okay. So we have seen what happens in the lung. How the gas exchange occurs in the lung between the blood and the lung or alveoli of the lung. Now, after the blood gets oxygen from the lung, the oxygenated blood should be taken to the tissue, because the blood will deliver the oxygen to the tissue, you know that. Why the tissue needs oxygen? Tell me.
To survive.
Why the tissue needs oxygen?
Metabolism,
right? Because continuously metabolism is occurring, and metabolism requires oxygen, you know that. So that's why we need to supply the oxygen to the tissues.
Yes.
Make sense? Okay. So the oxygenated blood will go to the tissue, and where the oxygen will get out from the blood and enter into the cells. And carbon dioxide will go from the tissue to the blood. Okay? Now, the pressure of oxygen in the blood that's going to the tissue is 100 millimeter of mercury, and the pressure of carbon dioxide is 40 millimeter of mercury in the blood. Okay, and the pressure of oxygen here in the tissue is 40 millimeter of mercury, and pressure of carbon dioxide is greater than 45 millimeter of mercury. Let's first see the oxygen.
Wait, what are you talking about?
The pressure of oxygen in the blood that's going to the tissue is what? 100 millimeter of mercury. Because that's oxygenated blood. Think that the blood is going to the tissue is oxygenated blood, right? So the pressure is high. What is the pressure? 100 millimeter of mercury. Now, in the tissue, the pressure of oxygen is only 40 millimeter of mercury. Okay? So in the tissue, these are the cells. Just think that these are the cells of the tissue. You have, what's the pressure of oxygen?
40
in the tissue. And the blood here inside the capillary, what's the pressure of oxygen? 100 millimeter of mercury. We're talking about oxygen, okay? So which way the oxygen will move? From the blood to the tissue. Make sense? Okay. What's the difference?
60,
because of that 60 millimeter of pressure difference from the capillary blood, the oxygen will go or enter into the tissue. Now let's see the carbon dioxide. The pressure of carbon dioxide in the blood, capillary blood, is 40 millimeter of mercury. So carbon dioxide is 40 here inside the blood, 40. And in the tissue, the pressure of carbon dioxide is more than 45 millimeter of mercury. So which way the carbon dioxide will move? From the tissue to the blood, because here is higher, right? Here is lower. So carbon dioxide will move this that direction, and oxygen will move from the blood to the tissue. Is it okay? Okay. So always remember that pressure gradient, pressure difference is the factor that will move the gas from one partition to the other. Okay? And now, again, here the difference of oxygen is 60, but carbon dioxide is only 5 or a little more than 5. But carbon dioxide is more soluble, right? So with less pressure, the carbon dioxide will move more than the oxygen. Okay, so that's what happens. So here you need to know the pressures of oxygen and carbon dioxide in the lung and the blood of the lung, in the tissue and the blood of the tissue. Make sense? So just know. If you know the pressure, then you will be able to see, tell that which way the gas will move from one side to the other side.
We
have
talked about that oxygen is more pressure.
Oxygen needs more pressure difference because less soluble. Okay. Now, ventilation coefficient coupling, we have talked about that, that your breathing should match with the blood when it's entering into the blood. The timing should be perfect. Okay, internal respiration, the exchange of gas between the capillary blood and the tissue. That is called the internal respiration. And we have talked about that already. The pressure difference of oxygen and carbon dioxide between the blood and the tissue. We have talked about that. So now, transport. Do you have any questions? We have talked about that. What is perfusion? The heart is sending blood to the lung, that is perfusion, right? And ventilation is what?
Breathing.
Okay. So those should be work together. The timing should be maintained. Okay. And internal respiration is between the tissue and the capillary blood. We have talked about that here. So that is the internal respiration. And this is the external respiration in the lung. Okay, now transport of respiratory gases by blood. How blood transports gases? We know that one important function of blood is transportation of oxygen and carbon dioxide, right? Transportation of gases. So blood transports oxygen, blood transports carbon dioxide. So if I ask you, tell me which way the blood transports oxygen from the which way the blood transports
the
oxygen from the from the first blood will take the oxygen from the lung, right, to the heart, and then heart will send that blood, oxygen blood, to the tissue, right? So that is how the blood transports oxygen from the lung to the heart and from the heart to the tissue. And how the blood transports carbon dioxide in opposite direction. Our tissue produces carbon dioxide because metabolism occurs in the tissue, right? That carbon dioxide will be taken by the blood and will be bring back into the heart, and heart will send to the lung that carbon dioxide rich blood, and carbon dioxide will get out from the blood into the lung. So that's how the transportation of gases occurs. Now, how the oxygen molecules are carried in the blood. Oxygen is carried mainly by the hemoglobin of red blood cells. We know that the hemoglobin binds with the oxygen. And 98.5% of oxygen will bind with the iron of hemoglobin and will be transported by the blood. 1.5% of oxygen will get dissolved in the plasma, the fluid part of the blood. Only 1.5% will be transported by plasma. So if I ask you which part of or component of blood will transport the oxygen mainly?
The iron.
The iron of?
Hemoglobin.
Very good. So what type of cell contains the hemoglobin? The red blood cells. Okay? So the answer is the iron of hemoglobin of red blood cells transport 98.5% of oxygen. Make sense?
Yeah.
Now, small amount, 1.5%, is transported by the plasma.
It's
fluid part, plasma of the blood. Dissolving plasma. Dissolve means it will get mixed with plasma. When you mix sugar,
it still goes to the...
Yeah, just think that when you mix sugar with the water, that's the dissolve, right? You dissolve the sugar in water. So, that way.
Oxygen
okay.
Gets found with the iron?
Second?
Oxygen gets found with the iron?
Yes, and form the ferrous oxide.
It's the iron that
corresponds to the oxygen molecule. Yeah, it will bind and relate. Okay. So, one thing we have talked about in the blood chapter that iron binds with oxygen. You already know that, right?
Yeah.
The iron binds with oxygen. And which form of iron is more capable to bind with oxygen? The ferrous one.
Plus
plus. Plus plus. Okay. Now. Oxygen hemoglobin dissociation curve. What is that? You know that hemoglobin binds with oxygen. Right? Now, there are some factors that can influence that binding. Okay? So normally, first we'll see how the normal binding occurs. This is the curve called oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve. So in this way, in x-axis, we plot the pressure of oxygen. Okay, so the pressure of oxygen 20, 40, 60, 80, 100 millimeter of mercury. And if you plot the percent oxygen saturation of hemoglobin, that means the saturation or binding of hemoglobin with oxygen. We know that hemoglobin binds with oxygen. So if you plot the binding in y-axis and in x-axis, if you plot the pressure of oxygen, more oxygen pressure means more binding. Make sense? If more oxygen is there, that means pressure of oxygen is more. And more oxygen means more binding. That is simple, right? So here you see, as the oxygen pressure increases, the saturation, that means the binding of hemoglobin and oxygen, increases. Very simple, is it clear? If the pressure of oxygen is more, that means more oxygen is there, so hemoglobin will get attached to more oxygen. That is simple. It will go like that. And at a certain point, the hemoglobin will start to get saturated. It cannot take any more, even if you increase the pressure. That is normal phenomenon, right? If something is saturated, it won't be able to take any more. So at certain point, you will see that increase is not sharp. It will start to get flat. That means in first part of that curve, if you see, the first part, the curve is very steep, very sharp rise. Small amount of increase of pressure will let a lot of hemoglobin to bind with the oxygen because the hemoglobin is empty. Initially, the hemoglobin were not attached to the oxygen. Make sense? As you increase the pressure, more and more oxygen will get attached, so the hemoglobin will start to get saturated, so the curve will get flat. Anyway, so if you plot the pressure of oxygen and the binding of hemoglobin and oxygen, you will get a curve like that. This is normal. In every adult person, if you plot the binding of hemoglobin with oxygen against the
pressure of oxygen, you'll get a curve like that. And that is called the oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve. Now, how that curve could be affected, how that binding or saturation of hemoglobin could be affected. Just remember, three factors can change that binding of oxygen with hemoglobin. What are those? One is temperature. If the temperature changes in the body, then the hemoglobin and oxygen binding will be affected. If the temperature is less, you see the first curve, the far left one, if the temperature goes down, the binding will be more. If the temperature increases, then the binding will be less. Okay? So leftward shift means more. You see here, this is the normal temperature, 38 degrees Celsius. The curve will be like this. We have seen that curve before. This is the normal curve. Now, if the temperature goes down, what will happen? Less pressure will bind more oxygen with the hemoglobin. That means the curve will shift that way. This is the pressure, right? So small pressure will bind more oxygen with the hemoglobin. So temperature is one factor. And another is the carbon dioxide. If the carbon dioxide is less, then the binding will be more. If the carbon dioxide is more, then the binding of oxygen and hemoglobin will be less. Okay?
Can so, you repeat again?
Which one?
The temperature. If temperature is higher, is there going to be less binding?
Yes. See the curve. Do you understand this curve?
No.
How many of you understand this curve? How many of you understand this, the first curve? Okay, so first thing you have to understand this curve. See here, let me explain this. See the blue one, this one, okay? So this is pressure of oxygen, right? This is pressure of oxygen, we have talked about that before. And this is the binding. Saturation. Now, if you compare this one and this one, these two, now, at the same level, just think that this level, here and this point, okay? Now, which one needed, the amount of binding is same, right? 40, here, for both. Is it clear? Okay. Now, which one needed more oxygen? This one or this one?
The one on the right.
Because pressure of oxygen this way, right? Mm-hmm. So this one needed much more oxygen than this one. That means this one will bind much faster. Okay? The binding will be more in less temperature. Now, how many of you understood this now? How many? Okay. So let me see. Again, raise your hand. I really want to know. Okay. So couple of you didn't understand. The red, okay. So you didn't understand, right?
The only difference I don't get is like, if it has more pressure, shouldn't it bind more? Because more pressure...
Okay. Yeah, more pressure will bind more, right? That's normal. That's true for everything. Now, in these two conditions, two different temperature, right? Now you tell me, this one is 10 degrees Celsius, this one is what? 38 degrees Celsius, right? Now, in these two conditions are two different temperatures, right? Which one will need less pressure, less oxygen to bind? This one, right?
Pressure.
Is it clear to you? So this one needs less pressure. This one needs more pressure. Make sense? So this one is more efficiently binding with oxygen. Less pressure, but less oxygen, but binding more. Make sense?
Okay. Is that because the oxygen is more dense?
Yes, very good. In low temperature, the oxygen is more dense in the air. Okay? That's why if you see the patient suffers from respiratory distress, if you put him in cold room, then he feels better, a little bit more comfortable because the oxygen concentration is higher.
But you're saying it's body temperature, but now you say putting the person into a cold room. Are you saying putting person into the cold room will lower their body temperature?
Of course, yeah.
So the temperature of the environment is different.
Everywhere. The temperature inside, outside, the temperature is the factor.
Okay, but if the temperature outside affects the temperature in the body, so yeah, you can hear your children.
Yes, one is in room temperature. In cold weather, the oxygen is more denser, you say. That's
because
true.
The body temperature is lower.
No, that is not related to body. That's outside of
the
body.
I thought that when you were saying that the difference of the body temperature.
Yeah, but in your body, if the temperature is low, then more oxygen is there.
Right, but now you're saying that the temperature will stay in the same is what is affect, it makes the body temperature lower.
Yes. So one is the hemoglobin. We release the oxygen and get attached to the oxygen. That release the conductor get attached to the oxygen more if the temperature is low. That is one related to hemoglobin. And another is related to the condensation.
Well, at first I thought if a person has a fever, then they're warmer.
Right.
So then they would. Then their body would less ability
to bind with the oxygen. Yes. And another factor is outside temperature. That is different issue. In that condition, in the air, the density of oxygen is more. So two
not,
different factors.
It is that it changes the body temperature? Or it isn't that it changes the body temperature? The cold air outside?
If the temperature is less outside the body temperature, will not be much affected because your body will try to keep the temperature normal, right? But the density of oxygen in the air is more. So you are inhaling that air, right? So you're getting more oxygen inside. That's the difference.
So it's not necessarily the body temperature is different, but the temperature of the oxygen is a different quality. The density of the oxygen is of a different quality. When the air is
cold.
So
that's a different issue. Density of oxygen molecules.
But that's not this.
Okay, so how the oxygen and carbon dioxide is transported by the blood, we are talking about that. Now, carbon dioxide transport. Carbon dioxide is transported in three forms. What are those three forms? 7 to 10% of carbon dioxide will dissolve in plasma. So carbon dioxide will dissolve more than the oxygen in plasma, right? In case of oxygen, it was only 1.5. In case of carbon dioxide, it is 7 to 10%. 20% carbon dioxide will bind with the globin of hemoglobin and form carbaminohemoglobin. So 20% will be transported by hemoglobin, but will bind with what? Not with the iron, but with the globin. 70% will be transported as bicarbonate ion in plasma. So, if I ask you, in which form most of the carbon dioxide will be transported?
Bicarbonate.
Very good. What happens? The carbon dioxide gets attached to carbon dioxide will bind with the water of plasma. The plasma is mainly water and will form bicarbonate ion and hydrogen. Okay, so after the carbon dioxide will enter into the plasma, quickly it will bind with water and will form bicarbonate and will be transported as bicarbonate, and when it will be taken to the site where it should be delivered, what will happen? opposite reaction will occur. They will again join and form the carbonic acid and carbon dioxide and water will be formed and carbon dioxide will get out. So 70% will be carried as bicarbonate.
Is that why when you breathe like on a mirror it's a little wet?
No, that's the condensation, but that's different. When we breathe,
well, we breathe carbon dioxide and water.
Blood, but it is how it is transferred in the blood.
Is it blood?
Okay, so you said when it gets to the site, so then what you mean is that when it gets to the lungs.
To the lung, or to the tissue, right? To the lung, where it should be delivered.
So it gets into the blood, into the veins, right? So then veins bring to the lungs.
Yeah, we are talking about.
Then it's out of
the opposite. So, see here, what happens in the tissue? In the tissue, from the cells, we know that tissue produces carbon dioxide by metabolism, right? And carbon dioxide from the tissue should go to the blood, okay? And carbon dioxide, most of the carbon dioxide will bind with water and will form carbonic acid and that will split into bicarbonate and hydrogen and will stay. From there, it will get out from the red blood cell. This is the red blood cell. It will get out into the plasma and will remain in the plasma as bicarbonate, okay? So that is number one. 70%, that's why you see it is very thick. 70% is binding with carbon dioxide, forming bicarbonate that will stay in the plasma. Okay? Now, 7 to 10% will dissolve in plasma and will not change, will stay as carbon dioxide in the plasma. Okay? And then, carbon dioxide will also bind with the globin of hemoglobin and will form carbaminohemoglobin and will stay as carbaminohemoglobin inside the red blood cell because hemoglobin is located in the red blood cell. Okay, so those are the three forms how the blood will get attached to the carbon dioxide and transport the carbon dioxide.
But what do you mean that it will stay there? Once it
gets to the lungs,
it will go out?
From the lung, it will go to the tissue. From the tissue, it will go to the lung, right? So it should stay there and go to the lung.
Oh, it will go out in the lung.
Yes, go to the lung. Now, if you see here, what happens in the lung? Now, that blood will be taken to the lung, right? That carbon dioxide in those three forms will be taken to the lung. And you see exactly opposite things will happen in the lung because we know that in the lung what should happen? From the blood, the carbon dioxide should go to the alveoli of the lung, right? So you see here, that carbon dioxide was staying in the blood as bicarbonate. What percentage is that?
70.
70, very good. So 70% will stay as bicarbonate. So bicarbonate will go back into the red blood cells and will bind with the hydrogen ion and will form the carbonic acid. And very fast, the carbonic acid will split into carbon dioxide and water. Exactly opposite reaction, right? And that carbon dioxide is now getting out, entering into the lung, alveoli of the lung. That's 70%. Now, let's see what happens. Dissolved carbon dioxide, that was as carbon dioxide dissolved in plasma. That is easy because it is as carbon dioxide there. It will enter into the lung.
Okay, so what happens to the water in the lung? Does that dissolve into
the lung? This is in the blood. We are talking about blood. Okay, now.
So the carbon dioxide goes in the lungs, but the water stays in the blood?
Yeah. Okay, now carbaminohemoglobin. Hemoglobin, the globin, will release the carbon dioxide and carbon dioxide will enter into the lung. And why the carbon dioxide will enter from the blood into the lung? Because of the pressure difference. We have talked about that, right? That 5 millimeter of mercury pressure difference will move the carbon dioxide from the blood to the lung. So that's how the carbon dioxide is transported. Now we'll see in the tissue, what happens to oxygen? Who will deliver the oxygen to the tissue? The blood, right? The blood will release the oxygen to the tissue. So you see that, we know that 98.5% oxygen is transported by hemoglobin, the iron of hemoglobin, right? So that's why you see this red line is very thick. 98.5% of oxygen will be transported by hemoglobin, and in the tissue, the hemoglobin will, iron of hemoglobin will release that oxygen, and that oxygen from the blood will enter into the tissue because our tissue needs oxygen. Okay.
And small amount, 1.5%, stay dissolved in plasma. So 1.5% will go from the plasma to the tissue. Make sense? From the plasma to the tissue. So that's how the oxygen will be transported. In the lung, we know that from the lung, the oxygen should go to the blood, right? So you see, 98.5% will bind with the hemoglobin and form oxyhemoglobin, and only 1.5% will dissolve in the plasma. Okay, so that's how the oxygen is transported. Okay, now the control of respiration. Just know that in the brain stem, you know that brain stem has medulla and pons. So brain stem has the respiratory centers. So respiratory centers are located in the brain stem. What are the respiratory centers present in the brain stem? Three respiratory centers. The pontine respiratory center in the pons. This is the pons. This is the medulla oblongata, okay? So in the pons, you have one respiratory center that is called the pontine respiratory center. Okay? And in the medulla oblongata, you have two respiratory centers. The ventral respiratory center or ventral respiratory group, and the dorsal is in the back, dorsal respiratory center or dorsal respiratory group. Okay, so those
the
are
dorsal
the respiratory group or center, whatever you say. So two are in the medulla oblongata, the ventral and dorsal. And in the pons, one, right? Pontine respiratory center. Now, the dorsal respiratory center, I'll just mention one or two functions of those respiratory centers you need to know. So the dorsal respiratory center or group integrates peripheral sensory input and modifies the rhythm generated by the ventral respiratory group. So just know that the dorsal respiratory group collects the information from the periphery. What is periphery? From the lung. Okay. So from the lung, the information goes to the dorsal respiratory group. Now, what information should go to the dorsal respiratory group? When you are inhaling the air, right, your lung is getting what?
Expanded.
And the wall of the lung, we have the receptors that can detect how much expansion has occurred, okay? The stretch receptors, okay? They can detect that how much expansion has occurred. So that information will go to the dorsal respiratory group, okay? Is it clear? So dorsal respiratory group will collect information from the lung and will monitor that how much expansion has been taken place. Okay. Now, just think that you are inhaling the, if I ask you to inhale the air more, at certain point you have to stop, right? Even if I ask you to do more, can you do?
No.
No, you won't be able. You will be able to do, but
if I keep telling, do more, you have to stop at certain point, right? Yes. Why you are stopping that? Because when your lung is expanding, those receptors in the lung are sending signal right to the
dorsal. Is it clear? Okay.
And dorsal is watching that and getting that signal. Okay. And when the dorsal respiratory neurons think that no, it shouldn't go anymore, then it will explode. Okay. So the dorsal center will send signal to the
ventral respiratory center.
And ventral respiratory center will tell the muscles, the respiratory muscles, you know that out of the respiratory muscles, your diaphragm, your intercostal muscles, right? Will tell the respiratory muscles to exhale the air out. You won't be able to hold it for a long time. You have to exhale it out, right? So it will tell the ventral center, and ventral center will send the signal to the respiratory muscles. So if I ask you what's the function of the ventral respiratory center or groups, sending signal to the respiratory muscles to cause the breathing. Okay, that's the function of ventral. So again, I'm repeating that dorsal and ventral are located in which area of the brain?
Middle
of placenta. And dorsal is doing what? Collecting the
information
from the lung. Lung is located outside peripheral organ. Okay. Now, ventral is doing what? Ventral is getting signal from the dorsal and sending signal to the respiratory muscles. Is it clear? And causing the breathing or respiration. Yes. Now, the guy sitting in the pons, the pontine respiratory center, he is the boss. Okay. So if the dorsal and ventral, they do anything wrong, then the pontine will tell them, okay, you do this way. So the pontine is the one that smooth the respiratory pattern. So it will monitor the activity of ventral and dorsal and will guide those centers. And if anything is needed to be adjusted, that pontine center will tell that you should adjust this and will ensure the smooth breathing. Okay, so just know those three centers and three functions. Okay, so we'll talk about last few slides in next class, then we'll start the next chapter.